Good morning.
Good morning.
Good morning.
Oh.
Sounds a little rude.
Okay, well, we got a couple of things to say.
Thanks. Good morning, good morning.
Good morning.
Hi.
Happy first Sunday, happy, we're entering into September.
Amen.
And so today for communion, what I heard the Lord saying is that this is a new season. And I think it was stated a couple Sunday ago that we're stepping into some new areas, some new levels, some new, just new. And so what I always, whenever I do communion, I always like to do something a little bit different, do something a little bit new. I will read the scripture, I will get to that, but I always want to hear what the Lord is saying to us, because
Amen.
This communion is not just a thing that we do, it's it has a purpose. So I was thinking about it on my way to church this morning, it's like, you know, why do we do this, right? What does this serve? And there's a couple things that came to mind. One, I've said in the past that communion is like our agreement with what God has already said over us, what he's spoken over us. And so in this season of new, we're just coming into alignment and saying yes. And then this morning when I was kind of getting ready for church, I heard this song and it said, I'll just say yes. And it just kept reminding me, like, okay, this is a new season, we're coming. We got to kind of come, not to say we were out of line, but it's just like we got to realign, we got to recommit. You know, like when you're in the Army, you got to re-enlist. You don't automatically just go in there and stay there forever. You got to say, okay, yes, I'm coming back. And so it's like this re-enlisting, this realignment, just reconnection to what God has for us. And so, like I said, the song that kept playing, that was playing this morning, says, I'll just say yes, you lead the way. I'm not afraid of what it means for me to say that this life you gave is not my own. I'm trusting you to hear my yes and lead me on. So that's what communion is. Amen. It's us saying yes. It's us saying, you know, we recognize his sacrifice. We recognize that he died for us. We recognize that we are recipients. We are beneficiaries of that sacrifice. And because of that, all of the things that we have access to, as we were talking about even in prayer this morning, that we have access to wisdom. Right? We have access to resources. We have access to bravery. We have access to joy. We have access to all the things that we stand in need of because of our connection to him. And so that's what I wanted to kind of remind us today in this communion. And then the second thing is, again, that it's an agreement. So I like to say sometimes people learn in a lot of different ways, right? Some people learn, they can just learn by the lecture. Like you just talk at them and they just keep all that information. Those are great people. I'm not one of them people. Some people have to like write it down. You have to take notes. You have to, you know, look at it again. You have to read it again. Some people are like tactile. And what that means is that they have to like do something when they're learning new information. And so when I was thinking about that, I was like, communion to me is kind of like a tactile remembrance, because we have to take the cup, right? We have to eat the bread. We have to drink the grape juice. It's all of this like kind of physical connection almost to what we're trying to remember. We're trying to remind ourselves again of his sacrifice. We're trying to remind ourselves again of the connection, the communion, the agreement that we have with him. So this is just the one. God's such a wonderful person. He said, I'm going to make sure you remember it in a bunch of different ways. We got the scripture. We're going to speak it to you, and you're going to do something. So that's what communion is, to what we're going to do today. So I'm going to read 1 Corinthians chapter 11, verses 23 through 20. When I stop. Sorry. For I pass on to you what I received from the Lord himself. On the night when he was betrayed, the Lord Jesus took some bread and gave thanks to God for it. Then he broke it in pieces and said, this is my body, which is given for you. Do this in remembrance of me. In the same way, he took the cup of wine after supper, saying, this cup is the new covenant between God and his people, an agreement confirmed with my blood. Do this in remembrance of me as often as you drink it. For every time you eat this bread and drink this cup, you are announcing the Lord's death until he comes again. So anyone who eats this bread or drinks this cup of the Lord unworthily is guilty of sinning against the body and blood of the Lord. That is why you should examine yourself before eating the bread and drinking the cup. For if you eat the bread or drink the cup without honoring the body of Christ, you are eating and drinking God's judgment upon yourself. Let us pray. Father God, we just thank you for allowing us to remind ourselves today of who you are. Father, that you have given us the ultimate sacrifice of your Son on the cross, that we may have access to our right relationship with you, that we may be in right standing, that we may be in alignment with your purpose and plan for all of our lives. Father, we don't take it for granted for what you have done for us. And Father, we just want to remind ourselves each and every day, not just in communion, but each and every day, of what it is that you have done for us and how we can have access to all the things that we stand in need of. God, we thank you for your ultimate sacrifice, because no one could have done what you did for us, Father. We thank you for your Son. We thank you for the Holy Spirit. God, we ask that you would touch each and every one of us, every person that comes through these doors, that they would be met with your presence, met with the Holy Spirit, met with your love, met with your peace, whatever they stand in need of, Father. We say thank you. In Jesus' name we pray. Amen. All right, let's take the bread. Let me do this in remembrance of him. And the cup. We do this in remembrance. And I'll just say one last prayer. Father, we just thank you again, Father, that we can remind ourselves of what it is that we have in you, who we are in you, how we can access you, that you are our Father. You're not somewhere high in the clouds where we can't reach you, but Father, you come down to where we are. Yeah. You meet us where we are. You meet us where we stand in need. You meet us in the dark places. You meet us in those secret heart places, Father. And so we just say thank you for access to not just life, but abundant life in you, Father. We say, have your way today in this service. Amen.
Amen. Amen.
Wise and understanding among you. Let them show it by their good life, by deeds done, and the humility that comes from wisdom. But if you harbor bitter and envy and selfish ambition in your hearts, do not boast about it or deny the truth. Such wisdom does not come down from heaven, but it is earthly, unspiritual, and demonic. For where you have envy and selfish ambition, there you find disorder in every evil practice. So just to decipher that, it really comes down to, you know, when it comes to being wise, you know, and understanding that you gotta have wise people around you. I would say, you know, the wise people you have around you are blessings, and the unwise people you have around you are lessons. So you're gonna learn either way.
Definitely.
Yes.
Amen.
Amen.
So, just want to pray to wisdom. Dear Father God, just want to pray that you give us wisdom every day.
Yes.
That you let us learn from our mistakes. Let us learn from our successes. Yes. Let us learn from the people we have around us.
Yes.
Dear Lord, I want you to continue to look down on us, continue to guide us, continue to just help us find peace, help us find community, Help us find, harmony within each other. Help us build a better world, a better planet to everybody, to harvest and create and grow, whether it comes growing spiritually, mentally, physically. In Jesus' name we pray. Amen.
Amen. Amen.
Amen, amen. Praise the Lord, everybody. It's so good to see everybody in the house on this morning. Hallelujah. Yes. Ain't God good?
Yes.
Let's tell you one time. Is God good, people?
Yes.
Yes, He is. So, as you see, I'm standing before you. For those that are watching on eCam, please welcome. Hallelujah. So, I have had the lovely privilege, I do not take it lightly, to lead worship on this morning. The Lord gave me three songs, and as I went to go shuffle this morning, I realized I had picked a song individually, but it's okay, Lord still gonna bless, all right? So the three songs that He did give me, the first one is by T.T. Wayne, Goodness of God, okay? So we got that on the first piece. But then the second piece is by the Time of Glory Ministry, which is off of their first CD, which is Temple. It's called Get Father Me. And doing that particular song, I want everybody just to really think about how good your Father is. And not only that, whatever moments that you may be going through, whether it's been a hard couple of months, a hard week, or whatever, but allow Him to hug on you, allow Him to love on you.
Amen.
Allow Him to father you. Amen. So the word got simple. He just asked me, just, He just saying, just father me.
Mm-hmm.
Father me. Sometimes we need that sometimes. When we kind of like go through a little something. Or not, and that's thing I don't have to go through. But sometimes we just have to have that reminder of the Father's love.
Amen.
And how great the goodness the Father is.
Amen.
Because there is nothing like the Lord.
Amen.
So allow Him just to rest on you. Allow Him to love on you. And then the third one we probably won't get to because I realize the second song is kind of long. It's about 8 minutes. So, and there is a little bit instrumental like toward the end, but just go into worship. I don't know what He's gonna do with me, but I just want Him just that. I just want to overtake Him. Just to overtake. I just want to feel His love right now. I just need Him like never before.
Amen.
Like never before. Because that's where we got friends from. If we can't get it from man, we can definitely get it from the Father. Mm-hmm. And that's what we have to learn how to lean on. Amen.
Amen.
Amen. Amen. So the first one is T.T. Wayne, Goodness of God. I don't know how I'm going to flow with this. That you all pray for me. I don't even pray for it. Okay, so let's go ahead and get started.
Amen.
Amen.
And lovely people, worship, stand to your feet. Don't worry about me. Let the Father do what He's going to do in this house. Just worship.
I love you, Lord, for your mercy never fails me. All my days I've been held in your hand. From the moment that I wake till I lay my head, oh, I will sing of the goodness of God. I love your voice.
Hallelujah.
Do I have anybody in this place that's willing to worship the Father tonight? Hallelujah. Lift those hands to the Lord. Jesus. Father. Me in your arms. Father, me in your arms. Father, me in your arms. And follow me. Father, me in your arms. this place just to worship Him. Come on, just worship Him, come on, just worship Him. Come on, just worship Him, worship Him, worship Him, worship Him. Come on, come on. Come on, you've been without long enough. But the Father is here tonight. You've been without protection long enough, but the Father is here tonight. Some folks that messed over you and picked on you, and folks that just did you wrong, but the Father's here tonight. He's here to pick you up, and He's here to put a little alcohol, a little metaphor on your leg. He want to heal you, He want to make it feel good, and make it all better. Come on, let the Father just love you tonight. Come on, let Him look you.
Yeah.
Share some testimony of what God did while they were in Uganda. And we just believe in the Lord gonna send not only them on more missions, but I'm just believing God has prepared us for some missions. We just gonna see what the Lord says. Amen. We had a recent request. We gonna investigate it, but we had someone reach out to us from Kenya and said that they would like for us to cover them as their apostles. So we said we're going to look into it and see what the Lord say. The Lord say yes, then we're going to say yes. Amen. All right, come on. Come on. Come on.
Amen. Praise God. Good morning, everybody.
Good morning.
Good morning.
So I think I can just kind of start with telling you, like several years ago, like over 10 years ago, the Lord showed me a vision of me in Africa. I had like an overhead view of it, and I was just like, okay, so I kind of kept that in my back pocket. But I've had the privilege to go to, minister to a lot of like the Latin nations, you know, physically and then overseas and then here. So I was just like, okay, I know that's a big part of my call, but I know he showed me Africa as well. So maybe about like 5 years ago, I got like one of the first offers to go and minister in Africa. And then COVID hit, so that kind of was shut down. And then there was another offer to go to a different nation there, and God said no. And so I'm just like, okay, Lord, whatever you say. I know you said Africa, but this is a no. So this time, when it was extended to me to go, I started to pray about it, and the thing I just kept seeing and sensing was like, you need to go. He was showing me what was gonna happen there and what I would see from there. And it's essentially exactly what happened. So one of the things that I kept seeing, the person that invited me to go is one of my mentors, is Apostle Arthurine Wilkinson. She's a senior pastor at Manifested Glory over in Riverdale. And she invited me to go. And one of the things I kept seeing was that, was that wisdom would be unlocked in new ways, and that God had given her a key to Africa. And so prior to knowing that I would be one of the people that she would invite to go with her, the other thing that he said was that he was going to, through her, give keys to her daughters to also go to other nations in Africa. And so one of the things, she's kind of joked, but she's definitely serious, that she said to me and Tiffany both, is that you guys are going to go back even when I'm not, you know, with you. And so, yeah, so we're believing for more trips. But when I went, I feel like one of the things that was clear for me, I'm like, okay, God, this is great to receive, you know, this impartation and see this example. This is wonderful. I got to sing, you know, and several times there, which was a blessing, right? This is foreign soil and everything, but I was like, okay, that's great. People tend to feel like that's such a huge part of my call, and it's not. It's like a really small portion of my call. With singing and ministry. And so I'm like, okay, that's great, but what did you want me here for? And so the second to last day that we were there, when Apostle Arthurine finished ministering, I was kind of serving, Timmy and I both were kind of helping to serve as our armor bearers there and intercessors and things like that, outside of other ministry things that we did. I went to sit down and kind of sit behind her and kind of cover her in prayer. And then like a line started to form, and I was like, oh, you know? And so people were coming up to just, you know, bless us and greet us and things like that. But then people from the praise team and the choir started to come over. And a couple of things that they kept saying was like, I want you to pray that I sound like you and I sing like you. And immediately I was like, okay, this is my assignment, right? Thank God for the other pieces, but this is my assignment. And part of that was to really break comparison. And if you were there, the Sunday before we left, that was one of the things that God was talking about in that message, right? Not worrying about what was in the hands of the others around you, but to realize what God had put on the inside of you, evaluate that and use it. And so as that line came up, I was able to bless and pray and prophesy and, you know, break that spirit of comparison, specifically off of the music ministers and the singers and things like that that came up. And so really quickly, I just want to read scripture from Romans 10, 14 and 15. It says, but how can they call on him to save them unless they believe in him? And how can they believe in him if they have never heard about him? And how can they hear about him unless someone tells them? And how will anyone go and tell them without being sent? That is why the scripture says, how beautiful are the feet of the messengers who bring the good news. So part of the good news that I was supposed to bring to those, that group specifically, was that God has a sound that he wants to come from you, right? He doesn't want it to sound like me. We may have a similar message, but he doesn't want it to sound like me, right? He needs your sound specifically. And so I was like, and I was telling some of my friends as I was leaving, I said, I feel like Sunday is supposed to be a preview for Africa, and that's exactly what it was, you know? So I'm grateful. I'm so thankful to each and every one of you that, you know, sowed in prayer and time and faith that it was going to happen. I am so grateful to you. It was an awesome experience. We got to try different cultural foods. We saw some different cultural customs. And I think another thing, too, for me in the way of impartation, watching the apostle that we were with, was that she very firmly stood in her authority, whether she was talking to men, whether she was talking to other bishops, other apostles. She would very clearly ask her what she needed or say, this is what we're going to do.
right? She ministered in deliverance that second to last day that we were there. And then also just very, it's funny too, because her message echoed that same thing, like you have to open your mouth, right?
Yes.
I can praise, your bishop can praise, but you have to open your mouth.
Yes.
And so I feel like that's a big thing that God is, again, same thing I said in the message, like if he's echoing and repeating something, it's so important. Right? He doesn't want people to be muzzled, right? He doesn't want people to be quiet, but he requires that sound to come from them because he has use of it and need of it. Amen?
Amen.
Hi, everyone.
Hello.
Hi. And so, first of all, I just want to thank, just like the same sentiment she said, thank everyone that sold into me. Being able to go over to Uganda, I truly do appreciate it. It was a wonderful experience for myself. First of all, I had kind of, I guess, voluntold myself. I asked about, you know, we were in a car and we were just like, Leslie was just talking about the trip. And I was like, ooh, I want to go, because everybody know, if you know me, I love to travel. I love to travel, always had a heart to travel, even before getting saved, like just wanted to do like missions and things like that, trying to find different ways to like go over to different countries, helping out people and things like that. And so I wasn't thinking anything of it, and she said, you know what, I forgot the exact words, so I'm paraphrasing. And so Leslie was like, okay, I'm going to ask. I was like, what? Don't do that. And so she asked, and here we are. She actually replied back, Apostle Wilkerson, they didn't have any space left, but it was made possible through God and through her, me being able to go.
Amen.
And so I was just thankful for that. I remember something that my Apostle Jewel Williams said. I may not be saying it to the T, but just being able to, when God wants you to be able to say something to someone, or you may be called to go here, you may be called to go there, you have to be ready.
Amen.
And so just going over there, it was wonderful. I was just going as a spectator in my mind. So, little do I know, God has something else planned, because I was given the opportunity to preach over there, to preach to the nations. And I was very nervous, to say the least, but God was with me.
Yes.
And I was able to just get over that fear, you know, fear of like speaking in front of people, because the Lord has been like doing a work on me for years about that, because Lord knows I could be comfortable just sitting right there in that pew, warming it up. That's not what he wants me to do. And also just, you know, going over there, just helping out the people. Wonderful, wonderful spirit. The love of God, the being able to just, the praising, the worshiping, over there, it was beautiful. It was a beautiful thing to see, and it just got me to want to even do more and put a fire in me even more to even want to praise and worship, because I'm thinking to myself, if they can do this, if they can praise and they can worship, and you know, I praise and worship, but I'm saying praise and worship, just being thankful for what God can do, even the little things, being thankful for the little things, them being like servants, having servant hearts. It was wonderful to see, not to just having the servant heart for only for their apostles, but just for everyone, having that true love. It doesn't matter if you was a pastor or apostle. They were just willing and just loving on everyone.
Amen.
And so I just love to see that. it just brought a, it was just different. And I just thank the Lord that I just got that opportunity. I know I just kept on apologizing about preaching until last week because I was like, oh, I went over time. But everything happens for a reason. And so I'm just thankful and grateful that for every little thing. And I don't take, I try not to take anything for granted. And I just was very thankful for the opportunity and just wanted to see even more what God has in store, not just for myself, but for everyone, because God is doing a thing. He's doing a new thing.
Yeah.
He has always been doing a thing. He's waiting on us.
Amen.
He's waiting on us. And so, just be for me, and I know I probably said this before, for me, it was just like an eye-opener in terms of myself and just having the Lord just work with me in terms of like even taking the muzzle off, you know, not being afraid, just being open, you know, just doing His work, His will, His ways. And so that's all I have. But it was a wonderful experience. I just want everybody to have that same experience. And I'm just hoping and praying that one day that we all will get that experience.
Yes.
But until then, we can still have the experience. We still have the experience here while we're here in the U.S.
Yeah.
It doesn't have to be just going over. We can do it right here, right now.
Yeah.
Why do we have to wait? We can do it right here, right now. Because that's what God wants us to do. He wants us to open our mouths. He wants us to just continue to witness to His children. And He wants us, no matter where it is, to do it right now. Right here, right now.
Amen.
And so, just that charge, I charge you to do the same.
Come on.
If you have a mouth, praise the Lord.
Yeah.
If you have a mouth, worship the Lord. If you have a mouth, give Him praise. Give Him thanks, because you never know when your last breath is. You never know. You never know. So just take the opportunity to do it now, because God is good. God is everlasting. God is faithful. He can do it. He can do it. And He does it for any one of us. He can do it for anyone that is even in the nations, even over here.
Amen.
So just continue to open your mouth. Continue to praise Him. Continue to worship Him, because that's what He wants. He wants to put that fire in each and every one of us.
Yes.
Amen.
Amen.
Amen. And she thought she wasn't going to say nothing.
Yes.
Yes, He will. Amen. Amen.
Morning, everybody.
Good morning.
Talking about faith over fear. I'm fired up here. So, welcome to the e-campus for folks that are in the house. Everybody that will hear this, let the Lord lead you and guide you. I'm Apostle James Williams. We talked about today earlier in prayer that the theme for the month of September, and actually it's my theme every day, is wisdom, because I'm always asking the Lord, what is it that you need me to do? What is it that I need to hear from you? And how do we operate in that realm and really get the wisdom from God that we need? And so thinking about that and really thinking about what the Lord would have for us to hear today from Him, amen. He brought me to Luke, the second chapter. Oh, that's right. Well, let me finish that sentence and then go back to what I was supposed to do first. Luke, the second chapter, verse 52 is kind of the core. And I was supposed to actually say, this is our opportunity to be the cheerful giver that you have been made to be by the Lord. So if you're online, you can see it pinned in the comments. And if you hear it in the house, it's on the screen. We also accept money in addition to the electronic funds through Zelle and Cashapp. Thank you. You can tell I'm a rookie at this.
It's okay.
It's okay, thank you. A lot of grace in this house, I appreciate that. But really though, one of the things as it relates to giving and being a cheerful giver is Apostle Joel and myself and everybody that is you know, in leadership are really asking the Lord to give us wisdom in terms of how to be a good steward of the resources and funds and anything that we're blessed with. And so in that vein, I just want to lift up a prayer around A, being a good steward, so that we can do the things that God has called for us to do to reach the lost and equip the saved, and B, to actually pray for you, to pray for each and every one of us, because we look to the Lord for provision in every area, and you know, in the society that we live in, sometimes you need a little cash. So let me pray. Father, in the name of Jesus, we thank you, Lord, for those that have heard from you and that want to be a cheerful giver. Those that want to give into the kingdom, Lord. Lord, we pray that each and every one of us that has the opportunity to be a steward of these resources would use them to the upbuilding of the kingdom. That we would use them to do things that would be helpful for people so that they can be saved and delivered. Also, Lord, we pray that you give us wisdom on how to invest and seed into people, Lord, so that they can go out and do God's work, Lord. We're here to help and partner with individuals as they follow the Lord, and we want to make sure that we have our resources so that that can be done with a spirit of excellence.
Yes, God.
Not comparing to any other organization or team, but that we continue to strive for excellence in everything that we do, Lord. So I pray that you would touch their homes, touch their bodies, touch their families, Lord. Give them the connections that they need so that they can provide for themselves. And not only that, Lord, that they would have an overflow of provision so that even they become stewards of what you have provided for them, first acknowledging you as the one who provided it, but then acknowledging you and asking you, Lord, what do I do with these resources? Where do I sow? How do I touch somebody? How do I encourage somebody? Where do I invest what you have given me, Lord? So I pray for an overflow for those, and then the wisdom to use it wisely. In Jesus' precious name we pray. We can all say amen and amen.
Amen.
Thank you, Apostle Jewel, for telling me to do what I'm supposed to do. Because, you know, I get up here and be right in the Word. And I'm not going to preach the whole Bible today, so, you know, you don't have to get your pillow and everything. But I am going to touch on what God called for me to touch on today, because as I asked him, he said, you know, Jesus is our model. And that's why he took me to Luke, the second chapter, verse 52. But before that, just to set everything up, what I want to do is I want to go back to Luke, the second chapter, verse 41. And I'm going to read it through 52 in the King James Version. Excuse me. And then I'm going to touch on a couple of things. I'm going to pray with you, because ultimately at the end of the day, and I talk about this a lot, what we get from God is contingent upon what we want to get from the Lord. We have to really lean into what it is I need today. How do I need something to help me with my mind, my spirit, my body, and everywhere? How do I understand what the Word is saying? What does it mean for me in the context and the situations that I'm in each and every day? So I'm always on that applicability. Lord, help me get wisdom. Because when he talked about Jesus, he said Jesus grew in wisdom, stature, and favor.
Yes.
Wisdom, stature, and favor. And so that's kind of the core of what I want to touch on today. But let me get into the Word. I'm going to break down a couple of definitions, and then I'm going to pick, as the Lord leads, a couple of things for us to pray on for ourselves so that we can be activated. Then I'm going to turn it over to Apostle Jewel, because we have some things to go on after this. So Luke, the second chapter. Verse 41. Now his parents went to Jerusalem every year at the feast of the Passover. And when he was 12 years old, they went up to Jerusalem after the custom of the feast. And when they had fulfilled the days, as they returned, the child Jesus tarried behind in Jerusalem. Can we say that? Jesus tarried behind in Jerusalem, Jesus tarried behind in Jerusalem because he had a purpose. He had something on his mind. He knew that there was something that needed to happen, amen, in Jerusalem. As I go forth, and Joseph and his mother knew not of it. Because sometimes your parents don't even know. Sometimes your friends don't know. Let me keep going in the scripture. It says, but they, supposing to have been in the company, went a day's journey, and they saw him among their kinsfolk and acquaintance. And when they found him not, they turned back again to Jerusalem, seeking him. And it came to pass, amen, after three days, they found him in the temple, sitting in the midst of the doctors, both hearing them and asking them questions. Sometimes you need to ask the Lord a question. Sometimes you need to ask the saints a question to get clarity, amen. And all that heard him were astonished at his understanding. And when they saw him, they were amazed. And his mother said unto him, son, why hast thou dealt with us? Behold, thy father and I have sought thee, sorrowing. It was, oh, where is Jesus? And he said unto them, I love the red letter parts of the Bible. How is it that ye sought me? Wist ye not that I must be about my father's business? And when they understood not the saying which he spake unto them, and he went down with them and came to Nazareth and was subject unto them. But his mother kept all these sayings in her heart. In verse 52, this was the result, the outcome, this is the purpose. And Jesus increased in wisdom and stature and in favor with God and man. Be about my father's business. We talk a lot about business today, how we standing on business. But Jesus was really, you say?
Amen.
Jesus was really, thank you, it don't fit in here. It doesn't fit. Jesus was really about to stand on his father's business.
Yeah.
And that is the way that he gained wisdom, stature, and favor.
Amen.
So let's just unpack wisdom, stature, and favor, because that subtitle of wisdom, stature, and favor was really, wish ye not that I be about my father's business. We have an opportunity, as Pastor Tiffany and Pastor Leslie shared, we offer our hand, we have opportunities, and when we have those opportunities, we need to step up, we need to speak out, we need to ask Lord, we need to speak what it is we need in order to do what God has called for us to do. So wisdom, as I shared earlier in a prayer, was wisdom is the ability to judge correctly.
Amen.
Amen. And apply truth in specific situations. Judge correctly, apply truth in specific situations. And not only that, wisdom is also the ability to see the big picture. See, sometimes we just see a little bit in part. We see how so-and-so is acting. We see what's popping over here. We see this situation over here. We see that. But there's a big picture that God is trying to impress upon us that we need his wisdom to understand that big picture. But not only that, to understand the relationship between each part. We're going to experience something where we're going to have to speak out, stand up, stand on truth. And that's going to be related to something else. It's not always for us. Sometimes it's for us. And then just like we look to Jesus, somebody's looking to you.
Yeah.
Did they tell the truth in that situation? Did they really change when they said they were following Jesus? Because I'm sure people looked at me coming up as a teenager. And then I was like, oh, he in the church. Is he really a Christian?
Right.
Because I'm sure they was like, I remember, people have long memories on dirt.
Yeah, yeah.
And just to keep it a buck, I do too. I remember. As you may remember when somebody did something that was vile to you.
Yeah.
And it really takes the God's spirit to come in and give you that spirit of forgiveness, because you saw what, how he forgave you in order for you to actually forgive that person. So that wisdom, judge correctly, apply that truth in different situations to really achieve God's ends. Because sometimes we'll get truth, and then we'll say, okay, well, I know I can use this to influence so-and-so. I can use this to manipulate somebody. I can use, because I know more than they know, I can try to trick them to get my ends. But wisdom is only used in those situations to achieve God's ends. So that's just something for you to check yourself on. Because when you really reflect on why you did something, you can be like, okay, I did this because I know I can get mine. Or you can say, Lord, help me not to use what I know, not to take advantage, not to manipulate somebody in order to get something for me. You know, because we really own that money, power, respect thing. We want money, power, we want influence. But what we really need is the Lord to help shrink our ego so that he can lift us up in due time. Amen. So let me press on. Stature really simply is respect. Are you holding somebody in regard? Wisdom, stature, respect. Amen. And then favor. Thank you, Jesus, for favor. That's really divine goodwill.
Yeah.
It's not something we earn. It's something that we get. It's a gift from God when we surrender to him. And then he's able to give us favor. And most people know that when you get favor from God, you recognize, ooh, that really wasn't fair. I really wasn't supposed to be put to the front of the line. I really wasn't supposed to be readmitted to the university after I failed that first 6 years and couldn't get over the finish line. I really wasn't supposed to be here talking to you right now because I was out there doing whatever I wanted to do, and what I was doing was something that was breaking down my body to the point where my physical death was imminent. But for God's favor.
That
unearned gift from God, the result of surrendering, saying, you know what, Lord, I'm tired. As Brother Torian said this morning when he was praying, sometimes you're bumping your head up against that brick wall. So at one point you say, you know what, I quit.
Yeah.
I'm going to stop trying to do it myself. Surrendering, getting that favor, and then you get the gifts, the time, the talent, the treasure, and ultimately that favor is to be used to do God's will.
Amen.
Amen, amen, amen. So, the wisdom of God, this is really the core of it. The wisdom of God, I really have 10 points, but I'm not going to do all 10. The Lord said, you know, in the beginning, not so much Genesis 1:1, but in the beginning, when you think about wisdom, it's all about who do I get that wisdom from? And how do I get it? And then how often is it like, I wake up, Lord, give me wisdom on how to deal with stuff today. I get it, and then I'm good. Then tomorrow, I got that yesterday, I don't really need none today. I'm here to encourage you to seek it every day, every situation. And here's the affirmation is, Lord, I yield to your wisdom. Because we get a lot of noise from a lot of different sources, but we have to decide that, Lord, I yield to your wisdom today, aside from what I thought, because I think I'm pretty smart, aside from what so-and-so said, because I really respect them. Lord, I yield to your wisdom.
Yeah.
And I decree that it increases daily.
Yes. Yes.
Lord, I yield to your wisdom, and I decree it increases daily is the affirmation, it's the activation, it's the theme, the first one. I'm only going to do like two or three, and then I'm going to turn it over to Apostle Jude. Lord, I yield to your wisdom, and I decree it increases daily. And what I want to do is pray into that for each and every one of us. As you reflect on them all, I'm going to be quiet. You reflect on them all. Where do I need to yield? What do I need to yield to? Who needs to be set into the right perspective and taken off my high horse of, I always say that so-and-so, they're always right. Who needs to be taken off that throne and put, Lord, your wisdom is where I'm at.
Yeah.
And
I'm gonna be one of those people, like, you know, when folks work out and they work out consistently and they, you know, they start to achieve things or they read consistently, and how do I get that every day?
Yeah.
I just, and I'm sure, you know, y'all super saints and that happens all the time, but I just want to encourage somebody. And myself, Lord, I yield to your wisdom and decree it increases daily. Yeah. Let us look to the Lord. Father, in the name of Jesus, right now, Lord, speak to the spirit of each and every person that can hear or see, that they would say, today is a day that I'm going to yield to God's wisdom. Today is a day that when I open my eyes and take that first breath, that I'm aware of that, Lord, you are the one that created me. You are the one whose wisdom I'm going to follow today. You are the one that's going to help me make my decisions today. You are the one that's going to allow me to set aside my petty agenda, amen. You are the one that's going to set aside these circumstances that I've been responding to ignorantly, Lord, and I'm going to respond wisely. You are the one that's going to help me have an even keel, even when my emotions are going up and down. You are the one that I lean on today, Lord, for wisdom. You are the one that's going to help me without a shadow of a doubt, no matter what I believed yesterday. Today, I'm going to believe you. Today, I'm going to listen to you. Today, I'm going to trust and obey you. And not only today, if you wake me up tomorrow on September the 2nd on my mother's birthday, I will say, Lord, I thank you for your wisdom. I need it today. I need it to help me with the way I make decisions. I need it to help me the way I think. I need it to help me with what I move, what I eat, how I go, where I go, who I see, who I don't see. Today is a day, and then if I wake up on September the 3rd, Lord, I want more of your wisdom. Lord, I pray that you touch each and every person, that they will remember you, that they will trust you, that they will obey you each and every day, that you give them life.
Yes, God.
In Jesus' precious name we pray. Amen.
Amen.
And amen.
Amen.
Yes, God.
Thank you, Jesus. All these 10 points are good. It's hard for me to decide, Lord, but I know you want this one to come out. So, if we're alive and we hear and see things, we know there's a whole lot of foolishness going on today. And that's the best I can come with. Greg, my homeboy Greg, guys who've known me since I was 13, know I had some other words to fill in that foolishness gap. But thank you, Jesus. Those are a memory. And this is foolishness, because we're dealing with a lot of foolishness. There's some people out here who believe that, oh, I'm better than you. You don't deserve to be here. Oh, you think you're going to get this spot? No, you ain't, because I'm going to block you. Oh, I don't like the way you look. I don't like the way you talk. I don't like what you did yesterday. The stuff you did 10 years ago, I don't like. I don't like this. I don't like that about you. And guess what? I'm going to be in opposition to you. And not only that, I'm going to talk about you when you're not around. I'm going to spread some foolishness to some people that I know that's foolish enough to listen to me. And that's going to be a hindrance to you. I cast that spirit back to the pit of hell from which it came. Yes, and I empower through the Holy Spirit that you hear, the Holy Spirit, and you do the same.
Yes, God.
Pray in the spirit that is crushed. Yes. Jesus killed sin and death because he lived.
Yeah.
The Holy Spirit allowed him to be resurrected, and that same spirit is available to us today. Yeah. We need to war against that foolishness.
Yes.
And recognize that it can be divinely overturned.
Yes.
Amen.
Thank you.
Divinely overturned. Now, I came up in the thing before I got saved where I was like, oh no, we're gonna handle this. We gonna handle this in our own strength.
Yeah.
It's not enough of physical strength to deal with what we're dealing with in the spirit.
Yeah.
We need a bigger God than us little bitty God that we thought we was, because we thought we were standing on something. We need the Lord to help us. We need to tap into that power so that we can divinely overturn the foolishness and the spirit at the root of it. So then we can start to say, this is what God is doing.
Yes.
Because that is our ability, our opportunity to dismantle in spiritual places was being manifested in the physical.
Yes.
So here's the activation and the affirmation. Every agenda of foolishness is divinely overturned. That's the first clause for you English students. Every agenda of foolishness is divinely overturned. Not in our own power, but in God's. Second clause. And dismantled by the wisdom of God.
Yes.
That's how we apply what he gives us. Yes, it's going to have practical application. Yes, so you can excel and be the best. And people can recognize you. Men can understand and see you. But the other piece, the spiritual root of it, needs to be dismantled by the wisdom of God. So ask for both. Lord, help me in the practical. Help me in the spiritual. Just to say that again, we're going to pray into it. Every agenda of foolishness is divinely overturned and dismantled by the wisdom of God. Because my Bible says that there is no power greater than the Lord. Nothing can come against it that can ever succeed ultimately. And that's what we want to access. Every agenda of foolishness is overturned and dismantled by the wisdom of God. Let us pray. Father, in the name of Jesus, today, Lord, we want to humble ourselves before you. Lord, we want you to speak to us each and every day, as was previously indicated. Lord, help us to see in the spirit what is coming against you, Lord. What might be manifested that is coming against you. What might be manifested here on earth that has a demonic root in the spirit, Lord. And today, we pray that you give us the wisdom to stand on our Father's spirit and say, Lord, today is the day that we tear down anything that comes against the word of God, that's coming against the power of Jesus and our Father in heaven, that it is cast back to the pit of hell from whence it came. And everybody that is standing in alignment with, Lord, we pray that you convict them in their heart, that they would turn from their wicked ways. And Lord, we say today that you are the one that is showing us the way to war in the spirit, so that it is not manifested here on earth, and that we would be the light, the children that you have called in this day to stand on, the kingdom of light, the kingdom of love, and that every day that we have an opportunity to reach out and reach for some wisdom from you, the Father in heaven, who has it, that we pull down that wisdom, and it's manifested today. It's manifested in the way we think, in the way we pray, how we stand, what we say, where we go, and everything that we do, Lord. We cast out anything that is coming against you back to the pit of hell from which it came.
Yes, God. Yes. Thank you, Jesus.
Every agenda of foolishness is divinely overturned, Lord, in Jesus' name, and dismantled by the wisdom of God.
Yes, God.
Each of us has separate assignments on that. I don't have the same assignment as Apostle Jubal. You don't have the same assignment as my brother here. Everybody has assignments where that is going to be activated, where it's going to be critical that you are doing that in order for the kingdom to move forward. That's what God is calling for us to do. And that's what we need to be about. Be about your Father's business.
Amen.
Be about it. Now I do need that water. Okay, last one. You know, it's funny how God will show you yourself sometimes.
Mm-hmm.
While he shows me this the last one, I've got to pick one out of these 10. Lord, I need your spirit to show what the people need to see today. But as I was reading this and reading about Jesus and how he was like, be about my Father's business, it reminded me of when I was a teenager. I went to school in New Jersey, in Lawrenceville, New Jersey, and it was about 700 students there on campus. I was one of the 14 folks that looked like me. And we used to be, together a lot. And so, we were from all over the country. I had some homeboys from Brooklyn, New York, East New York, you know, Washington Heights, Cleveland, Ohio, Philadelphia. We was all from everywhere, but we was all kind of, had similar, kind of probably lower middle class, just going that. We was like brothers from the hood type kind of thing, because it was all boys school, but that's a whole other story. We'll preach on that later. we used to come together and really, like, what are we focused on? You know, how do we protect ourselves in this situation? Because we had some folk that was like, I remember one guy who was from California, rich dude. He was like, y'all better be quiet over there. We was like, y'all, who is my person, James Sherman Williams Jr. I don't know who y'all is. Y'all keep up, cause we was, you know, we felt like, look, it's 17 of us, but y'all not gonna mess with us. We not having that. It's not gonna be nothing. This ain't 1617. We not in slavery no more. And they used to literally, like, y'all better be quiet. Y'all need to, y'all. Like, they was talking to us on behalf of all black people. Which I reject categorically, because I'm not like anybody else, and neither are you. So nobody should be able to generalize and say, y'all, and apply you to everything. So that's the first thing. The second thing was, what do they think we own? And so we used to have a lot of instances like that. But we used to come together and encourage each other. It's like, look, man, I'm gonna be about the beer bounce, and the beer bounce gonna be about me. And that was us, you know? And when I read that in the Bible, I'm like, oh, Jesus was about his father's business? Okay. That took it to a whole nother level. And what was so tripped out was, I mean, that happened, I was 13. I'm talking to my homies now, we like, you know, 50-something. He's like, Jim, you remember when you said, you know, I'd be about the beer bounce and the beer bounce there? I'm like, yeah, I do, but I didn't know you remember that. Anyhow, back to the word, so Apostle Jewel can come up, because we got so much in store. And not so much we, but the Lord has for us. And it's been a collaboration of folks praying and bringing that wisdom to us so we can grow in the Lord. Okay, so God told me. Number 8. So, in this time of newness, wisdom being applied, the application comes in ways that we are building. We are building in many different areas. And each of us has a specific role in that building process, because it's like the collective energy is what you see now is a collective, like, oh yeah, they gonna sow in and pray, and all these different things come together as a collective in order for something to be established. And as we are establishing something new, because God is pushing us and challenging us, as we've seen, he said, there's a thing that we need to remember, that just like we access wisdom every day, we also are accessing his grace every day.
Yeah.
And his grace, and here it is, this couple of clauses. Grace is upon me to build effectively.
Yeah.
Grace is upon me to build effectively.
Yeah.
Grace is upon me. And this is for you. This ain't just for me.
Yeah.
You. Grace is upon me. This is what you said. Lord, I feel, I know, I see. Grace is upon me to build effectively. Key. In all. I had to count. 4 areas. The first area is relationship.
Mm-hmm.
Grace is upon me to build effectively in all relationships.
Yeah.
Relationships. Yeah. And grace is upon me to build effectively in health.
Yeah.
Temple. No temple. No. Health. Grace is upon me to build effectively in business.
Yeah.
We already touched on where we get the business from. Father, what's your business? And then how is it manifest? The vertical Father, I'm standing on that. And then how is it manifested in the earth? Whatever that is for you. And then the 4th is financial. As the Lord profits you, provides for you, it's like we touched on from the tithes and givings and peace, stewardship, financial stewardship. And all of that is, I'm going to say it and I want y'all to say it after me. By the wisdom of God. By the wisdom of God. Grace is upon me to build effectively in relationship, health, business, financial matters. By the wisdom of God.
Amen.
That's the capstone.
Yes.
And then I'm going to turn it over. We're going to pray. into that. But first, take a moment to say, just sometimes, I suffer from just being vulnerable. I suffer from, man, I got a great idea. Or as the two of us, we got five great ideas. And we try to do all five at one time. But by the time we get, I can't even catch my breath. Because as Apostle Joe has reminded me, you ain't God, you ain't Jesus, you ain't the Savior. You can't do everything. But by the grace of God, with God's people, His kingdom work can be accomplished together. What we got to do is kind of reduce the friction of working together. And we do that, as you probably know, by the wisdom of God.
Amen.
So I'm just going to pray. Grace is upon me, you, us, to build effectively in all relationship, health, business, financial matters, by the wisdom of God. Father, right now, Lord, as earnestly as we can, Lord, we are coming to you to reveal to us, Lord, where it is that we can receive your grace. Receive your grace in how we relate to one another, Lord. Lord, we thank you for giving us the words of caution, the yellow lights, the red lights, and giving us the green lights as we relate with one another, Lord. Lord, help us to put ourselves and have a divine perspective taking to understand even how people are coming to us or how we are engaging with them, Lord. Lord, help us to see beyond the initial interaction or what they're saying, Lord, to the spirit that is at work, Lord, that is the true motivation, Lord, so we can discern how we move in relationship with others, how we partner, collaborate, avoid, move out the way, how we connect, how we even entreat into other individuals, Lord, when we have to sow a seed or when we have to share a word of correction along with love and encouragement. Lord, help us to have the grace to do that in a way that honors you. And Lord, even as we think about and reflect on every action that we take, Lord, everything that we drink, everything that we eat, everything that we observe, everything that we consume, either audibly, visually, I don't know how to do the part about smelling, whatever that olfactory. Lord, everything that we receive, every situation and circumstance that we're in, Lord, help us. Give us the grace to use, to do, to decide, to move in a way that promotes health, in a way that sustains life, in a way that helps others to see how they too can get the grace from you to govern themselves accordingly, Lord. Lord, we know we can't do everything in a day. We're not trying to do that, Lord. But today, if it's just one thing that we can do to promote health, one thing that we can say to encourage somebody, one thing that we can think about, Lord, because our health is not just our bodies. We recognize, Lord, that you have given us a spirit, amen. And we need to feed that spirit with good food, Lord. Lord, help us to improve our spiritual health and then allow it to manifest itself in the things that we do, Lord, in the decisions that we make, Lord. Lord, I pray right now that each and every one of us has that one suggestion, recommendation, yea, commandment, amen, from you on what we will do today differently than yesterday that will improve our spiritual, mental, psychological, emotional health. In the name of Jesus, we know that without that temple, without that spiritual guidance, Lord, we cannot stand on our Father's business. Yeah. And Lord, we want to stand on our Father's business because our Father's business is what is fruitful. It's where we get the gifts from heaven that are pure and useful, and it allows us to manifest that in any way that you have given us to do it. Lord, even as we manage our business, even as entrepreneurs or those that have an opportunity to earn, even if it's not monetary, Lord, we pray that we're still standing on our Father's business so that we are about our business and not a busybody, amen, and that we are all about doing something that's going to help somebody and promote them, strengthen them, encourage them, show them you, your son, listen to your spirit, Because as your business is manifested in us, and as we are able to earn in every realm, earning wisdom, stand in stature, first with God, receive your favor from God as we become those stewards who are driven, led, guided, and are part of your kingdom. Help us to be great stewards of every resource. And we know that if we ask every day for your wisdom, that you will give it to us. Lord, I pray each and every one, each and every soul, is able to guide themselves to build and have the grace, to build effectively in relationship, health, business, and financial stewardship by the wisdom of God. May God bless you and keep you. Amen.
Amen.
And amen.
Amen.
Come on, Apostle Jewel.
Don't go too far.
All right.
All right. So, well, you have a seat for a minute. So, what I'm here to tell you real quick is what I'm calling the 90-day press. Say with me, the 90-day press.
90-day press.
So, the way I'm going to start it off is what happened, I don't know if it was a year, maybe almost 2 years ago, somebody gave me, they had a dream. It was actually almost relatively a similar dream that I had. And in the dream, they said they saw me in this hot air balloon ready to take off, but it was like I was waiting on something. And so I was waiting, and then eventually God gave me the word and said, you can go. So we let go of the release and the balloon went up. And in the dream, the individual said, then all of a sudden these people came running out of the woods, so to speak, to try to get on. But I was like, it's too late. We've already launched. And so I was reminded of that even as we've been talking about what the Lord said in terms of us as a body, as a church moving forward. And God was showing me that he don't want none of y'all lost. He don't want nobody left behind. He wants everybody to be ready to go where he's taking us to our next. And so I've been praying about it. Others have been praying about it. And so starting this Sunday, the first, we are starting our 90-day press. And so how we're going to do that is for the next 21 days, we're going to do a different kind of fast. And you're going to all get the information, but I'm just telling you about it now. So on next Sunday, I want you to even come in ready to be at a place of repentance. Now, most people say, well, I don't need to repent. I ain't sinned. But if God has told you something and you haven't moved, if God has shown you something and you've let fear, doubt, anything get in the way, we need to bring that to the altar. And I'll be the first to tell you, I know what I got to come for, because me and that P word, y'all know I done struggled with that P word for the longest, patience. Me and patience, I'd be like, Lord, me and patience don't work well. And our family, he eventually told me, he said, Jewel, stop saying you don't like to be patient, because in fact, what you're really saying is you don't like waiting on me. I said, oh, I ain't saying that no more. Thank you. Lord, I'm going to wait on you. And so Apostle Orr will be bringing the message next week, but it's going to be a little different. It ain't been an hour long. She might be 15, 20 minutes, but she is going to prepare us. And like we did before, how we came to the altar and spent about 20 minutes just at the altar praying, that's what we're coming to do. Because that next day is when our fast starts. And so we're going to do 2 weeks of fast. Now, for those that may have never fasted before, I know some people say, well, if you don't do this fast exactly this way, you're not really fasting. For somebody that's never fasted before, if you ask the Lord to give you three things to give up, you give up those three things, he's going to receive that, because that's what your heart was in that place.
Yes.
For those that have fasted before, you can do the Daniel fast, and I'm going to actually have that in the information as well. So you can do that, or if the Lord tells you to do an absolute, which is nothing but liquid, then that's what you do. That's what he told me. I was like, okay. So I'm going to do an absolute. Everybody ain't got to do that. You do at the level that God tells you to do.
Amen.
That's going to be those first 2 weeks. Then that last week, we are doing what the Lord showed me as, and he gave me this some time ago, and it just blessed me. We're doing, so from September 23rd to the 29th, we're doing the intercession. And we have, and he gave me 1 Thessalonians 5:7, says, pray without ceasing. So on those days, what's going to happen, you don't necessarily have to pick 3 days to fast, because we're going to do a 6-6. 3 days, a 6-6. But on that week, you're only doing 2 days, and you will see, depending on what SWAT team you're in. SWAT means spiritual warriors advancing together. And so when you are in the, our sergeants, we got the 3 sergeants. Our sergeants for our SWAT teams are Minister Brenda, Dr. Marcus, and Prophet Michael.
All right.
And you will be assigned to one of those teams. And I got everybody, even our e-campus people are assigned. I'm going to send this to everybody to make sure everybody in this room, you are on the list. So if I don't have your email, make sure I have an email for you so that you can get this information. And so what will happen is we're also going to have some prayer focuses. Each day, some things that you can focus on as you're praying. I'm also, as Apostle was preaching, the Lord told me to take his 10 and add it to this list as well. So y'all will get all 10 of what his affirmations and decrees were. Why are we doing this? Because we're ready to go up.
Amen.
And we want to prepare ourselves for it. Also, in part, we are preparing for our next location, physical location. And we're asking the Lord to help us as a body, pray for that to open up and for him to show us where we go. We've been here now, this will be 9 years. This space has blessed us and has served us, but we need to expand. We need more space. We need classrooms. We need some other stuff. And God says he's going to do it, but we're going to partner with him in wisdom to do that.
Yes.
Everybody understand the instructions?
Mm-hmm.
We all clear? All right. Now, for the prayer that normally what we do, we would end at this point and pray. But those that were the intercessors for today, I'm going to have you just come and pray from here for the people, but pray based on what it is that God has even been speaking. So, and Pastor Apostle James will finish it off. So we're going to start with Pastor Darla, because you're on ministry today. So we're going to start with Pastor Darla, then we're going to have Elder Raina, and then Apostle will finish it up. Amen?
Amen.
Anybody got any questions? No questions? Like they say, all hearts clear. All right, let's go.
Father, in the mighty name of Jesus, God, we just want to say thank you, Lord God, for the word that was released on today, Father. Father God, I'm asking you right now, God, that you continue to impart us wisdom. Wisdom in everything that we do in our lives, oh God, concerning everything that we do, Father, that we don't do it among ourselves and our flesh, Father God. I'm asking you right now that you will expand our horizon, our mindset, Father, to go to think even more bigger, to think even more outside of the box, Father God, so that we can trust you with the wisdom you have imparted inside of us, Father. We cancel every doubt, every fear that may get in the way right now in the mighty name of Jesus, Father. Father God, I'm asking you right now, God, that you continue to be with us, oh God, as you see fit for this, for our next, Lord God. For the next location, Father, right now in the mighty name of Jesus, oh God, where you are sending us, Father, and you are sending us as soldiers on the front line, Lord God. I thank you right now that you are willing to ready to do whatever that next is going to look like, Father God, but we have faith and we trust you that when we do get this building, oh God, that it's going to be everything that you have orchestrated, every design, every blueprint that we want what the building should look like, Father. But we ask you right now, we pray right now for the community, Father. That when people walk in the door, Father, they always they know that you are in the house. That they are coming for you, Lord God, and nobody else. That I'm asking right now that you will be in this place. on today like you already have been, Father. So I say thank you, what you have been waiting to do for such a time as this. And during this next 90 days, Father God, do something around you, do something unusual. For each and every person that under the sound of my voice, Father, even for those that even watching on the East Campus, Father, that you begin to do something new, and you begin to speak like you have never spoken before, Father. Because I believe we are in a new season of something new that we have not yet to experience, oh God, but all we can do is just go up from here, Father. So I say thank you for the wisdom and for the new that is ready to take place. So I give your name honor, glory, and praise. In Jesus' name I pray. Amen.
Yes, oh God, we thank you. We thank you for the wisdom, oh God. We are calling you for wisdom, oh God, as we embark on the 90 press, oh Father God, that we will press into you, oh God. More of you, less of us, oh Father God, for each and every single person who is here, those who are watching on the e-campus, oh God, that as we are pressing into you, oh God, that you are giving your divine wisdom, oh God, on how we should fast, what to pray, even though we have prayer points, oh Father God, but you will give us strategic direction and insight on how to pray, how to fast, when to fast, when to pray, oh God. We thank you, oh God, that we will add to where we are, from where you have, but we will add to in your strength and in your power, oh God. So we thank you, we yield to you, oh Father God. We call down fire, oh God, fire to burn up anything that is not like you, that is within us, that is stopping us from pressing and going forward, oh Father God, that as you give wisdom, that we will be able to carry the weight, oh Father God, that we will increase, oh Father God, not of ourselves, but increase more of you, oh God, and the things of God, oh Father, that this is, as Pastor Tiffany said earlier, this is a new season, for you have been doing things, oh Father God, but we are yielding to you, yeah. We are partnering with you, oh God, for what you have for it, oh Father God. We thank you, oh God, again for wisdom. As Apostle Jules said, this place, oh Father God, was good for the 9 years. And we thank you for this place, but we thank you for what you have in store for us, oh God. We thank you for that new place, oh God. We thank you for the leaders that you have given them and are giving them wisdom, oh Father God, how to steward, how to shepherd, how to prepare the new place for us to go, oh Father God. So we thank you, oh God, for wisdom.
Yes.
We thank you, oh God, for wisdom.
Yes.
We thank you, oh God, for wisdom.
Yes.
Not just for our own will and our own being and doing, oh Father God, but the wisdom you give us that we can take it back, oh Father God. Are we not take it back, that we are carrying the wisdom in our homes, in our jobs, in our workplace, in our relationships, oh God.
Yes.
How Apostle James even spoke just now about how we have the right to carry and build right relationships in our health, oh Father God. So I thank you. We thank you. We bless you. We honor you for wisdom. In Jesus' name, amen.
Amen.
Amen. Amen. Father, we thank you for this time that you have given us together today, Lord. But more so, we thank you for what you have poured into each and every soul today. Lord, I pray that what you have spoken to their heart, what you have spoken to their spirit, resonates, sticks, Lord, and becomes a guiding light into their next, a guiding light into their role, a guiding light into every area that you send them. Lord, each and every one of us has a territory, a space, and a place where you are sending us, Lord. And Lord, while we are present in every particular area, I pray that you give us the wisdom and through your spirit give us the power to be effective as the children of God that you have called for us to be. Lord, let us point people to your son Jesus, that they receive him, Lord. Let us point people to the Holy Spirit to guide them, Lord. And Lord, we pray right now that just as your Father in heaven created us, we will accept the wisdom from God to do his blessed will while we have breath. In Jesus' precious name, we pray and say, amen, amen. And amen. God bless you. God keep you.